Hi there! You might be asking yourself why I'm standing in front of my entrance door. Well, the reason is that I just wanted to prove to you that my intruder alarm system still functions without a problem. As you can see, I got a notification on my smartphone because the on vacation switch of the system was turned on and the door was being opened. And if you're completely confused right now, then make sure to watch my DIY home automation intruder alarm system video. But anyway, with this system I feel a bit more secure knowing that nobody is inside my apartment. But this message on my phone alone doesn't really help me when it comes to identifying an intruder. So in this video, I will be using the ESP32 cam and the housing of an ordinary security camera in order to create an online security camera that integrates into Home Assistant. This way, I can not only watch a live stream of my entrance door everywhere in the world, but the system also automatically takes photos when my intruder alarm system gets triggered. So let's not waste any more time and let's get started. This video is sponsored by Altium. I recently switched over to their Altium Designer software and used it to create a couple of PCBs. What I can say is that it might take a bit of time to get used to, but the software offers pretty much everything you could ever need to design a PCB. So feel free to test the Altium Designer by yourself by following the link in the video description. The heart of this online security camera is, like already mentioned, this ESP32 cam board that you can get for just $6 from eBay. This board is basically an ESP32 development board to which you can hook up this OV2640 camera module. You can actually find the datasheet for the camera chip, which comes with plenty of interesting information on how difficult it is to get all the required data from it. For example, the array size of it is 1632 by 1232, which equals a total of 2,010,624 pixels, which look something like this according to the datasheet. So, if you theoretically have to sample each pixel individually in order to create a recording at full resolution with a frame rate of 15 fps, then you would only get around 33 nanoseconds of time to sample the data of each pixel, and thus you would require a clock signal with a frequency of around 30 MHz. Of course, this was just a simple example. And if you want more information, then feel free to dive a lot deeper into the datasheet to get all the juicy details. But what I wanted to demonstrate is that working with such a camera module requires not only a rather fast microcontroller like the ESP32, but also lots of efficient and thus not easy to create codes, which due to the internet and smarter programmer than me, luckily it does exist. So, for starters, let's have a look at the ESP32 cam example revisited project on GitHub, created by EasyTarget. After downloading it, I opened the ESP32 cam web server file and continued by installing the ESP32 boards for the Arduino IDE. At this point, I chose the correct development board and was about to click upload. But then I noticed that the ESP32 cam board does not come with a USB jack for programming. Instead, we have to use such an FTDI breakout board. After setting its voltage levels to 3.3 volts, I connected the breakout board pins to the development board according to this wiring diagram. And as soon as I connected the GPIO0 of the board to ground to put it into programming mode, I hooked up the FTDI board to my computer and finally uploaded the codes. Next, I removed the wire from GPIO0 as well as the FTDI wires and instead hooked up two wires to the 5V pin and ground, in order to power the board through my LabBench power supply. After then connecting to it by entering the password insecure password, I opened a browser and typed in its IP address, which sadly did not work for me at all. The only way I got this to work was by using the browser on my phone, and only there I was able to confirm that the camera can take pictures without a problem. Awesome! So, time to end this initial test, and hook up the FTDI breakout boards once again, just like before. This time though, I logged into my Home Assistant server, and created a new node in ESP Home, which I called Camera. And after choosing the AI Thinker ESP32 Cam as the board, I entered my Wi-Fi information and continued by compiling this first example code in order to download it as a binary file. I used this file and the ESP Home Flasher in order to upload the created code to the board. And as you can see, that worked out as well, because after hooking the board up to 5V power once again, the created node was available online, and thus it was time to edit its code. Thankfully, the ESP32 cam is supported by Home Assistant, so all I had to do was to copy a bit of code, edit the resolution, and add a few lines to add the onboard LED to the system. After then uploading this code through Wi-Fi, I added the entities to the dashboard and edited it in order to display the LED light switch and the camera picture slash stream. As you can see, the camera can stream a live image of what it is seeing, and we can turn on and off the LED of the board, which will come in handy later. But anyway, next we need to use the file editor add-on of Home Assistant in order to edit the configuration file, in which we have to add 3 lines to use the folder TMP for external applications. After then creating this folder, we can open developer tools and then services in order to select the camera.snapshot service. And as soon as we enter the correct service data, which defines the file path and name of our screenshots, we can hit call service. And as expected in this newly created folder, we can now find a picture which is the snapshot we just took. Perfect! As a side note though, the camera does not support recordings, which I otherwise would have also utilized. But nevertheless, next it was time to edit my door alarm automation sequence. So I firstly added the commands to turn on the LED light of the boards, followed by the commands to take one snapshot. Then I let the system wait for 5 seconds and then take a second snapshot. After saving this sequence, I did a small test with my door alarm trigger, and it seems like everything worked out just fine. Brilliant! And that brings me to my enclosure for this project, for which I ordered this all-metal security camera for a pretty reasonable price. As you can see, it already got some damages, because I tried to take it apart for half an hour. But I had to give up at some point and instead use the always reliable methods of commencing hammer time. The funny thing though was that the camera itself was super simple to take apart. On the inside we can find a PCB with lots of infrared LEDs, as well as the main camera board underneath. At this point I was wondering whether I could use the infrared LEDs for night vision snapshots, and thus I powered the security camera with 12V. First off, the infrared LED board directly works with 12V, and it also detects on its own whether it is dark or not through a photo sensor, which basically means we can toss out the camera boards without feeling bad about it. The best thing though was that the ESP32 cam does not come with an infrared filter, which means the infrared light was able to illuminate its picture. So I came up with this wiring diagram to power and control the infrared LEDs through the ESP32 cam board. As you can see, we will need a boost converter that creates 12V for the LEDs. Then we also need to add a MOSFET, which will turn on the infrared LEDs when the GPIO4 of the ESP board gets activated, to which the onboard LED was currently hooked up. So the first thing I did was not only getting rid of the male headers of the board, but also desoldering the onboard LED. Afterwards, I connected all of the components to one another according to the wiring diagram I just showed you. And at the end, I used hot glue to mount the components inside the enclosure, along with the original screw mounting methods. It is important to note though, that I also used hot glue to secure the camera right in the middle of the LED ring. And to power everything up later on, I also added a chopped up micro USB cable to the power wires. And with that being said, the online security camera was done. But before reinserting it back into its frame, I positioned it on my wall to mark the mounting holes for it, and then created them with my drill. After then adding wall plugs, I secured the frame to the wall, into which I then pressed the camera ball. Last but not least, I added cable conduits to my wall, so that I could hide the power wire in there. And finally powered it all with a 5V power supply positioned in the nearest outlet. And just like that, you can create an online security camera, which takes pictures of intruders without any problems. I hope you like this project. If so, don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!